How's 15 going for you so far? I've already had been in crisis. I've already so it, for me, it's going according to what I expected. Crisis. The next 18 months should be very much unfolding crisis. Much crisis. I have what people would call severe cold, but I don't call it that. I look at illness very differently. All illness is in the mind, 100%. Not one tiny exception is there. It's all in the mind. And what I do is I just observe it and look at the mind. How is the mind involved with this? And what is a play of the mind that's taking place? And I recognize when it first hit me is when I started making comments, unflattering comments about political leaders, etc. Yeah, one in particular, and that caused immediately. I felt something grip my throat in like a dark, sort of pretty ominous, fearful, whoa reaction. Like I said, wow, pretty weird. Now, but it's in my own mind. It's in my own mind. It's in the one mind. It's all we're all one mind. And so I've just been watching this what you call illness, and observing it and struggling with it, and seeing some amazing stuff. You look at it that way. My mind never thinks about medicine or doctors or treatment or anything like that. So therefore, the attention is no panic. I just say, oh, this is interesting. Okay, what's happening now? My voice is being affected. My breathing is being affected. It's interesting. Yeah, maybe they don't want me saying anything. You know, some don't want me to say anything. Anyway, I have a very difficult situation at night trying to sleep where I keep coughing and can't stop it. Like the bronchial area is like ticklish, so ticklish I have to. Like, but outbursts of coughing, just sudden, boom, explosions like this. It's amazing. I've never experienced anything like it. And I'm watching this, and I'm using my mind to try to counteract this. I said, hey, this is a very intense situation. And so I've been able to counteract it to some extent. And you find out in a crisis, what is your go-to move? What is your go-to baseline? In athletics, they always say that when the pressure's on, the most severe pressure's on, that's when you see what people always regress. They always go back to what they're most familiar with when the crisis is most severe. So for me, I found, what do I go back to? Teachings of Jesus, specifically the practices he suggests. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. The holy instant is mine to see. Various practices. My mind starts saying these. This is what happens when I'm in a crisis. Now I had this dream of I was going along on a boat and everything seemed fine. Then a horrible tempest came up that was blasting me from all directions, and I couldn't sail the boat anymore. And I called out to some young companion in the boat, some young person, and they took the sail and guided me into calm waters. Well, that's exactly what happened last night. The extreme instability and erraticness of this complex that I'm entertaining for some reason, was like a horrible tempest, mental tempest, and it's hard to explain it, how chaotic, explosively chaotic it was, and unstable. And I then went to my go-to move, which is these practices, which I've been telling everyone in the world, frantically telling everyone, please practice this, because you're going to need it. Now, it worked. It worked like a charm, like miracle. Worked like a miracle. I was able to drive away the discord, and it was as if I entered a peaceful sea. The winds were gone. It's like, wow. And what I came out of, just this super erratic, incredibly erratic, unpredictable, explosive chaos, into just calm, peaceful mental state, is just fantastic. So, reason why Jesus came here in thousands of years ago, and also recently with A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, has an outreach program going on here in the world in modern times. is because he was telling us that you need to practice this. And he gave us plenty of time so we could get familiar with this stuff. Why? So it would be our go-to move. It would be our go-to move when we're in a crisis. It would be that which we lean upon in a crisis. That's why. And in order for this to happen, you have to practice ahead of time, before the crisis hits. So this is why I spent my whole life insisting people, there's going to be a very severe crisis hitting in this world. And if you don't practice what you need to dispel this crisis, when it hits, you're going to default back to what you're most familiar with. And it's not going to be what works. What is going to be the default? The default is the ego. And what the ego always does, the ego knows ahead of time that its advice is terrible, atrocious, totally incompetent, worthless. It knows that. It knows that. And so the ego, knowing this ahead of time, knowing that we want the ego to advise us in times of crisis, knows that the advice won't work. So what is it? What is the ego doing? The ego is busy covering itself and realizing it doesn't want us to realize, hey, ego, you're giving us terrible advice. And so knowing that his advice is bad, what does it do? It sets up a plan for us called a plan of attack, a diversionary plan. And what the ego does is it scapegoats someone, some person, some group, whoever. It puts the blame for the bad advice, for the advice not working, on someone out there who's magically influencing you so that somehow the advice isn't working or you're not understanding it properly or something. So the ego plays what's called the blame game. Okay, it's very, 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 very much focused on the blame game. Blaming others for your own mistakes, for your own, for the ineffectiveness of its advice. Blaming others. This is what the ego does. This is its bread and butter. And this is what Jesus has pointed out to us so clearly. That what happens is, you're in a crisis, you're in this chaotic, insecure situation, and your thoughts are just like, wow, you think you're going insane. You say, oh, help, help, help. What am I familiar with? Oh, the ego. Okay, what's wrong, ego? Oh, someone there is influencing me badly, is undermining undermining what I need to do, is, you know, it's causing the problem. Oh, okay, what do? Attack them. One moment. What the ego tells us is, we can attack, blame and attack. And when we say attack, then we see a path, a road to that, towards that. And we seem to calm down and say, oh, I can organize an attack. Yeah. And so it makes us feel more organized, less chaotic, more in control. You see, I've discovered the problem and I realize I can attack that problem. This is the ego. This is what most people in the world are familiar with. And that's why in a crisis, that's why most people go into this mode, which is why it's easy for crises to turn into war and conflict. Very, 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 very easy. This is what happens. This is why Jesus brought in A Course in Miracles to explain this whole situation to us, knowing that this crisis was coming up in the world, of course. He knows about it. And so now, when we have a crisis, those who have been training with Jesus, they go into forgiveness, into, hey, truth is true, nothing else is true. Truth is true, nothing else is true. I am not a body, I am free. I am spirit, still spirit, as God created me. Truth is true, nothing else is true. The vision of oneness is mine to see. The vision of oneness brings me peace. The vision of oneness is the peace that I see. The vision of oneness is with me now. The vision of oneness is with me now. I relax my mind, release my thoughts, and let them go. And many permutations of this you can. And so I'm able to just spontaneously bring up all these practices and use that to dispel all this tempest, and it dispels it. I remain calm and centered. No attack, no one to blame, you see. I took full responsibility for the situation myself. Nothing can happen to me. It's impossible that anything can happen to me. Yet that it be my will that it does so. Okay. So this is the truth. there's nothing whatsoever that can ever happen to me, yet it be my will that it do so. See, so take full responsibility and then remind yourself of truth. And this includes all illness of all types. Includes all situations, all circumstances, etc., etc., etc. Nothing, no exceptions whatsoever. Therefore, you don't need to look for enemies or blame or anything like that. The cause is within us. The cause is our own delusion, belief in time. Belief in time, really. I release everyone from all grievances. And anyway, the ability to use these practices spontaneously in a crisis is what Jesus wants us to get to. And in order to do that, you have to be very familiar with doing this. So it's your first and best option. You feel like in a crisis, what do? You turn to the Holy Spirit, you turn to spiritual practices, and you say, I'm going to use these. And you don't even waver about something else. You say, no, full responsibility for how I feel, my situation. I'm going to use these to center, to calm, to bring peace into my situation. And so how do we get to that point where we can do this, as I have succeeded in doing? Practice, 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 practice over a long period of time. So you're so used to it that this is your life. The other stuff is unthinkable. Blame, you know, attack. What is that? I have no idea what that is. So it's lunacy, idiocy, insanity. I am total sovereign over my experiencing, complete sovereign over my experiencing. And I've never been a body, I've always been complete. I've never been a body, I've always been complete. So, there's nothing I need to do in order to feel absolutely sweet. Nothing I need to do. And we need to remind ourselves of this in a crisis, when our mind is being, when we project our mind to interface with the thoughts that the world is thinking and the cosmos is thinking, that can lead to incredible storms and tempests for sure. And you realize what's to come in this world. Wow, better back away from that cliff, that is for sure. And don't go there. So don't struggle with the struggle. Don't struggle with your thoughts. Full stop in the wow. Like, wow, I'm sovereign over my life. Totally. Wow. So, this is why I have stressed for years and years and years, practice, get used to these spiritual teachings. This is what will save you. This is what will save you. Because in a crisis, a mental crisis, which is what the world is going to go through, a mental crisis, okay, you will realize that it's up to you to deal with your mind. Your own mind. Nobody else can do it for you. There's nobody else that can do it for you. And that's when you will grab a hold of what you feel is the best way to do it. You'll have no choice. You have to. You say, oh my gosh, if I don't grab a hold of something, I'm going to lose my mind or something terrible. I mean, it's a crisis. And you'll feel that you're going more than insane. I mean, it's, you can't even describe it. You will grab a hold and try to stop it for sure. And there's nobody that can do it for you. It's your own thinking and thoughts that are happening. You see, this is, well, it's thoughts and thinking, but let's just put it this way. You will try to get some sort of stability and peace. So you have to practice, 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 practice. So many of the parables that Jesus used in the Bible are about being prepared, meaning practice ahead of time. He seemed to say so many times the parables about, hey, there's going to be a severe crisis coming. And here's an example of someone who didn't listen to to what was said, and others did, and look what happened. The ones that didn't listen, they're out of luck. The ones that did and were faithful and prepared, everything was okay for with them. So what Jesus is saying in so many of these parables is, don't wait for the crisis to hit you for then to say, oh gee, looks like I have a terrible crisis now. Okay, I need to start studying some spiritual teaching. It's too late then. It is too late. Because this crisis, when it hits you, I'm telling you, you're going to say, wow, this is a crisis. This is affecting my breathing. This is affecting my mind, my thinking, my beliefs. I don't feel like I'm really in control. What's going on? And it's getting worse. And the instability, and you just feel, oh my gosh, the instability, I'm overwhelmed. That's no time to say, hey, guess what? I think I'm going to, I need to start doing some spiritual practice and thinking about this. And you don't have 30 years to do this anymore. You know, the crisis is now upon you. So the whole point of Jesus' helping us out is prepare ahead of time. Prepare ahead of time. This is what I've been trying to say. I don't know if anyone's ever done it. I think most of us try to take the approach of, what would you say, the bluff their way through it. Like, you know, I don't need to do that. Me, Christ, in my mind can't suffer a crisis. Are you kidding? And they just don't admit to the fact that their minds could possibly suffer a crisis. And they think that by taking this stance, that this will protect them. No, it won't. No, it won't. So this also, I say, this is a path of humility. This is a path of repentance. Path of repentance means you realize your mind can very well be dragged down into a mental disorder. Mental disorder of all types. There's where you just feel like, wow, my mind is not functioning, you know, well at all. In fact, the functioning of it seems to be designed by a maniac or something. You know, it's just, wow, what is going on? I have no idea what's going on, you know, like that. And most of us say, no, that could never happen to me. I've got a college degree. That can't happen to me. Well, I have training in my mind that is, you know, I wouldn't trade with anyone's training in the whole world. And still, I absolutely can be vulnerable to that. No question about it. So this is what repentance and humility is all about, meaning you realize I do have to prepare ahead of time. I'm not just some, I don't have some immunity just because I have a diploma somewhere. You know? People will start popping all sorts of pills. I'm telling you what's coming. This illness, this mental situation, all illnesses are of the mind. This is a very unusual one. So unusual I can't even explain it. Hard to even explain. I'll be sleeping like this, and suddenly, pow, like that. This is shaking the shutters. Some just burst, sudden burst like that. And the sounds I'm making, like, I can't stop it, you know. It's like a dog or some animal or something. It, you know, you just look, what is that? What are these sounds? You know, where is this coming from? It's like you're being led down into some sort of animal-like functioning or something. Just odd, odd, odd. And odd enough to say, this has to stop. I cannot allow this. This is not allowable. Use my spiritual will and then start affirming your identity. Affirm your true identity. Because this is definitely trying to throw you into some very bad identity that can lend itself to conflict, to battle, to war, to attack, to anarchy. It's an anarchic, that's a word, anarchic. Anarchic mentality, where you're super impulsive. You can be super impulsive, where people will just be going along, everything seems fine, and suddenly attack like that, or suddenly boom. Yeah, it's just like, this is the mentality that is being pressed upon the world. where you have just normal people seem fine. Violent, erratic behavior, mentally, like that. So there's some sort of a global design that is here. And we can thank cosmic corporate culture for that. That casts a wide net, of course. Not all Denzians of the universe agree upon a particular culture approach, which is true. But there is most definitely like a corporation, a cosmic corporate culture, which has a basic alliance of thinking like this is what needs to happen on planet Earth. And they've incorporated this planet. And now they're going to likely impulse the world in a certain way, which will lead to the perfect situation, reaction from the world, and then the solution from them, which is, you need us. You need us. They create the need. They create the need for them by what they do. They make everyone feel like, wow, we're just losing it here. We really need someone who's oh, here they come. Of course, we manage many worlds. We manage many worlds. If you want an analogy, it's like, let's say there's a small little area, villages, and little towns, etc. And each town's got a little bank, you know, town bank. And there's many dotted throughout the countryside. And it's very local, and people, you know, the bankers, and they know you and everything. You know, it works great. And let's say a big mega bank targets them and say, you know what? You know, we want to take those over. What do they do? Well, what they do is they know their business about takeovers. They might create a recession. They might create a problem that the banks could go out of business. Well, they come and they buy the banks. They buy the banks. But they keep the name. They keep the same name. And they say, no, these are still your local banks and everything, okay. But they actually own them. They actually run them. And what happens is the people that work in the bank, you find them suddenly new people there. You don't know them. They don't know you. And the law, the rules start changing gradually over time. Because this is being run by the big mega bank. This is the way the cosmic corporate culture works. It assimilates worlds. And it works through like the countries of the world. And the countries of the world pass laws, and they agree to this and this, this and that. But really, it's the cosmic corporate culture that's running the planet and running these countries behind the scenes, telling them these are the new policies, but making it seem to the world that we're still governing ourselves. Okay, just like those little banks, town banks, people say, oh, these banks are still, you know, they're still in charge of themselves here, yeah. But they're not. They're not at all. You gradually are assimilated into the new way of doing business. Just so on this planet, we still think erroneously that the countries of the world, for the most part, are still autonomous. They're still human, driven by human values, and they're still, you know, governing themselves. Not really. They're taking orders from higher ups. There's a number of stages in all this. And they're being told, look, this is how you need to set things up in order to function in the new age. So, we can take just a moment as we're going through this information here. Don't have to, you know, forge ahead to stop in the wow of this. Feel this, like they say, hey, we don't really feel like we're being represented properly anymore. What's going on? This is very weird stuff going on real well. It's because we have been incorporated. We've been assimilated into this cosmic corporate culture, which believes that they have the answers for how to manage this planet in relation to the other planets that they own, which are many. And so they're going to help teach us to share our wealth. Come on, guys. You know, you need to understand that you're not the only planet on the block. You need to be part of a larger consortium, and you need to move goods and services and people, et cetera, workers, and share the wealth with everybody. It's they don't say that they depleted these other planets already, and through their materialism, lust for duality, trying to pamper themselves and et cetera, trying to make, because of their continuity fear, afraid to relax their mind, release their thoughts, and let them go and realize their true identity. They keep trying to make this universe their home, which it is not. Trying to make time, space, process, and form their home, which it is not. So they want us to share our resources with the other planets. Well, of course they do. Yeah, and what's going to happen to this world once they share all our resources with the other places of this planet? There will be nothing left of it. But they will have moved on to other places. They're always seeking, more resources. We need more resources. So they create situations, crisis, to produce reactions in the population, to then produce the solution, which they say they are the solution, and they ride in like white knights and say, hey, we have a lot of experience managing planets, and we're going to bring the know-how of the other planets that we manage to bear on this planet. Let's say there's a, it's kind of like the Federal Reserve riding to the rescue of some failed, Bear Stearns or some failed mortgage houses or whatever. And they say, hey, we have the strength to get you through this, or bail out. We can bail out GM or something. Yeah, we got the money. We have the resources. They say, we'll bring the technology, the resources, all the stuff that we know about. And we'll produce an economic miracle on this planet, and we'll put everybody back to work. We'll fix the economy. They'll say, we know how to do this. We've been doing this for, millions of years or whatever. And the people are just going to say, oh, wow, thanks. This is great. This is exactly what we need. Isn't this a miracle? God is great. They say, and of course, they will say, of course, that actually we made you. We are your gods. We are God returning. We're the ones that created you in the first place. Genetically engineered the bodies. It's complex because there's different groups, etc., etc. But this is sort of a gist of the whole thing. And so they say, we'll teach you, we'll share with you, you share our resources with us, we'll share all our knowledge and wisdom with you. We'll teach you how, new therapies and new medications, new ways to heal, new healing modalities. Wow. All you have to do is say, truth is true and nothing else is true. Just one of these statements by Jesus is enough to get us to release delusion and realize that we're absolutely perfect, totally sovereign, completely free. Spirit, as God created us. And we don't have any needs whatsoever. But they haven't quite gotten around to that yet, you see. But Jesus has.
Yeah.
And those who listen to Jesus most certainly have. So what's their deal anyway, What's their deal really? It's the question, isn't it? So they will tell us that they're the right move in a crisis. This is the go-to move, and we've been programmed for that through pop culture. What people crave is a common denominator in culture, common cultural denominators, so they know what to expect in social interactions. What the cosmic corporate culture has done in this world is mix all different cultures up around the world and tell everybody the common denominator is TV or movies or pop music, those things. And create this extreme agitation and oversensitivity and anger because you don't know what might offend somebody, you have no idea. So I know, like, for me, I can't function socially because I feel like I don't know what I can say. I'm sure it's going to offend somebody severely because there's all this mixture of culture and all these people buying into this baseline is, you know, Hollywood, basically. And they're telling us what we need to be upset about. And I don't know what to say. I don't know what to say around people at all. And most of us are this way. We feel like our interactions, we feel like, you know, I better be careful, I better be guarded, I better not get involved. I might offend somebody, I might get sued, I might be in the newspaper, I might have an activist descend upon me, you know. A lot of people are afraid to have pets now. That I might do something that you know, PETA, for instance, might, or some radical group might take offense at, you know. It's everywhere that someone might take offense. You don't know what. So this isn't by design. So we all feel extremely alienated right now. Now, this leads then to desperate need for some leader to rally around. Desperate need for demagogues to show up. For it creates a situation and then reaction to that and crisis, and then the solution is, oh, here's somebody who will create a common culture for us, you see, a global culture. This is what they're saying they'll do. Because right now we don't have a common culture in this world, except it might be these you know, this moronic, common culture of morons is what we have right now. It's totally moronic, which is what they want, of course. They don't want you thinking like, hey, only truth is true, nothing else is true. Truth is true, nothing else is true. Thank you. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit as God created me. Thank you, Jesus, for instance. They don't want that at all. They don't want that at all. You might question them, right? So they want you to be dumbed down. They want the common culture is to be dumbed down, severely dumbed down. So I feel extremely uneasy around people, simply because my mind and my thoughts are so strong in clarity that if I just start expressing and relating to people, they'd be like shocked. They say that I didn't see that on TV. Was that on Letterman? Did you see that on Letterman last night? No, it wasn't on Letterman, was it? Was that on the news? What news are you talking about? They're morons. Let's put it bluntly. Our common denominator now is moronic and insane in a lot of ways, actually, very insane. Now, my background was in previous lives was I was involved in creating a common culture. For many people, common culture, and it had to do with music, high class culture with, you know, the very best music, and those people who were educated, well educated, music was part of their education. They needed to be sophisticated in understanding the language of music and emotions and the deep symbology of it and all of that music can bring. So I was super, super involved with that. An expert at it. So I thought that I could come to this world and create a common culture and keep the culture from collapsing by trying to produce great music, by trying to get everybody, you know, together on the same page so you could reference, talk to each other in a musical way, actually. The poetry of music. There's a whole way of relating to people musically that used to be, like in Europe, very well known. Well, to say the least, that got crushed here, absolutely crushed, devastating for me. Still is devastating. the television, movies, and pop music just crushed it. Everybody said, yeah, I was watching this show last night, yeah. That's really cool. Yeah, that's really cool. Yeah, and that's the common denominator. Oh yeah, or you know, sports. I use sports because there doesn't seem to be anything else. Yeah, you won yesterday. Oh yeah, it was a good game, wasn't it? Yeah, it was great. There's no real soul spiritual interchange taking place in our interaction with one another. And so we have this severe feeling of alienation, really, and feeling of like, you know, I just don't quite belong. People just, you know, I don't quite belong, so I need material things. I need more stuff. I need more money. Maybe I'll feel like I belong if I get more money. And then we work, and become functionally insane, and never stopping for a moment. You know, I just see people on the street that said, how come I just can't go up to them, say, hey, you know, and say something that triggers, you know, like common cultural depth to it. You know, just like we used to do, you know, younger, back in the 60s, we had, you know, the counterculture, the music and everything. And you could just see any person your age at that time and just, hey, you know, brother, hey, sister. Yeah. Just say, hey, it's, what a groove, huh? What a groove. Just, let's hear about you. You know, we just started to talk and you get into heavy stuff right away. Say, yeah, what's the zeitgeist of the time? And you know, you could relate. And we wanted to keep that going through musically, but too many drugs entered the scene, too much stuff, you know, it was terrible. It collapsed. So when seeing that music collapsed as a common denominator, a high common denominator of culture, I thought, A Course in Miracles. I found A Course in Miracles. I said, this is going to do it. Jesus is behind this. And I said, this is the greatest teaching I've ever come across. This is incredible. No, it's amazing. It's great. Super great. Super, super, mega great stuff here. And I said, how about a common culture based on this teaching? Okay? Because we have this super divisiveness with, you know, evangelical Christianity and Catholicism and secular atheism and all this stuff going on. I said, hey, this teaching is something that everybody can really sink their teeth into. It's based on reason, self-evident reason. And it has the true love and compassion of Jesus so strongly behind it there, and you can't help but recognize it. So I felt, I put everything into that, and I felt that this was going to be a tremendous worldwide revival would take place, where there'd be this commonality of culture throughout the world of people, so many people able to relate through the basic understanding of A Course in Miracles. Well, that didn't happen the way that I expected at all. So that's been a colossal disappointment for me in terms of commonality of culture. It didn't unfold the way that I thought it would unfold, to say the very least. same old stuff, you know. So maybe it'll take hundreds and hundreds of years, but I don't think we have that amount of time to go here. So there's this desperate need for commonality of cultures. I hope these videos would produce that commonality of culture around the world. I hope people all around the world would watch them, and we'd have something we can talk, you know. It's like a TV program that people say, oh yeah, did you see Letterman last night? Did you see Clarity Ross's new video? It talks about, you know, people are doing that with Muji a little bit. Did you see, trying to create a little culture there? But it's like that. But I said, why not just have this like show where people can say, yeah, I saw the latest video. Yeah, the latest video talks about, you know, this and this and this and this, and spiritual practice. And have you been practicing this? And in other words, hey, you come see someone, hey, you know, it's like, wow, it's amazing times. That was really incredible. Or tribulation times. Are you keeping up your practice, you know? So when the crisis hits, you'll be able to, that'll be your go-to. That'll be the crutch you can go to and help you out. And how are you doing on that? And yeah, what are your struggles? And start talking to people about it and say, yeah, well, I've been, and reinforce their efforts. This has been my goal. The purpose of these videos is compassion. I feel I'm a compassionate spirit that wants to help. And I know what helps is now I know that these practices do help. But today I was driving and I realized, what do I really want? What I really want above everything else is to be absolutely certain that everyone's mind, everyone's spirit is perfectly safe and will come to realize this, that they're perfect and they'll be totally stable mind. Everyone, this is what I want to see. And I know this is true because in the vision of oneness, this is what I saw. I saw everyone is completely safe, and no matter what mental derangements are gripping the mind, and which it can be infinite. All of that is temporary. all of that is temporary, and the Holy Spirit will bring every single one back to realize original nature and realize this has all been a dream. And I want to be able to let people know this is true, because people are going to be in such crisis going forward now that they think that their mind is gone forever, that they're never be able to get it back. You know, they've gone cuckoo and can't do. And what I want to be able to do is just assure them without any question that that is not true whatsoever, that you will absolutely be perfectly sane and stable eternally, and much sooner than you think, actually. And there's not the slightest possibility that this trouble can last for you. Not any possibility. So I want to be able to give this absolute assurance to everybody. This is what I really want. If I ask, what do I really want? That's what I really want. This is what we all want for one another. Nobody wants anyone to be suffering mental derangement at all. Nobody. We all, our wishes for everyone is that our minds be sane. The singularity of isness, instead of this terrible trauma and drama of duality, of paths and attainments and realizations and needing to become and grow and evolve and learn and try to complete what we are and try to make a separate reality and then blend it with the original and all these things, believing we're bodies and this stuff. This is all insanity. And so my prayer to Jesus is just show me so that I may know, so I may convey this to others. Now, Jesus is absolutely sure that this is true, and this is what he conveys to those who listen to what he has to say. He conveys this absolute certainty. He says, you will feel the joy. It is there for you, guaranteed. Beneath this superficial drama is this absolute, totally secure certainty. We know what we are, and it's perfect. And it's within all of us. So Jesus is completely certain of this, and this complete certainty filters through to us. You know, I pick up on it. I feel it, and I say, wow, this is what I really want too. I want to be able to convey this to everyone also. Absolutely. So I say, I want to be another Jesus in that way, because what does Jesus do but convey this absolute certainty that nothing's wrong with our mind, our spirit, what we are. Nothing is wrong with reality. And we will know this, all of us will know this, without any single one of us being lost whatsoever. No matter how demented we may think we are at present moment, this is just a fleeting, idle whim, is all that it is. Nothing more than that. So, you know, these teachers are worth their weight in gold, more than their weight in gold. You can't even put a price on them at all. This their certainty, which is so important. Now, even when we're in a deranged condition, one might say all of us are in a deranged condition already, actually. The dream is to be deranged. We can still listen to truth. It's just that we don't trust, we realize that we're not stable, but we can still hear it. So even when people are very messed up and confused, the certainty can still impact them. At some level they can feel it like, okay, there is a way out of this. I am going to get well, I am going to get free of this. No question, okay. It's hard to say when an idle wish drop, we set it down. But sooner than we realize, sooner than we know, we will set this down and see it as just an idle, silly idle whim that needs no commentary or categorizing or, you know, analysis, investigation, or anything at all. It's just a silly whim, set it down, and that's it. Done with it. So this attitude has permeated me because of listening to Jesus. And getting familiar with it and feeling it. It's like, wow, this is coming from certainty. Not conjecture, but certainty. But those who feel so deranged, they have to start you know, waking up. You can't be forced to awaken. So these spiritual practices are super important. Super important. And I keep saying I'm going to just devote all the videos to practice, 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 and maybe I will. We'll see what can be done on that. But man, maybe what else can I do? What else can I do at this point? Because if you don't practice and you're not ready, you know, you can't drive that car, you know, then you're going to be in a mentally unstable condition going forward, most likely. But you could still benefit from the absolute assurance of those who are not bothered at all by this and don't even need to respond to it, don't even take it seriously. You know, this is very, very important, right? The insane say, get upset, but you don't take it seriously. But really, the right way to do is don't take it seriously at all. Say, you're just joking. Actually, you're just joking. This is just a joke. You just forgot to laugh. But someday you will laugh at it, guaranteed. And this is what really benefits. So it may seem that the great teachers are cruel or insensitive or something. No, they're not. No, they're not at all. Ron Maharshi didn't even pay any attention to what anyone was saying, really. He just was reassuring everybody. Everything's perfect. No worries at all. None whatsoever. He just dropped the whole thing. And I'm not even going to engage it. I don't need to engage at all at the level of taking anything seriously about this world. Very potent reassurance. So I've tried to produce videos with these great teachers, Ramana Maharshi, Anandamayi, Jesus, Longchenpa, various teachers, who have this absolute assurance that all is well, without any need to think about it whatsoever. It's not like someone who's really deranged will come up to them and they need to think, say, well, wait a minute, maybe this derangement is, I need to think about this one. Maybe this can't be resolved or something. There's nothing like that. Nothing like that. They don't view derangement as all these separate cases, actually. It's all just one silliness, is what it is. They know you will get well from this. All will get well. And so they're in very good spirits, you know, because they know the truth. They know how it all ends. It ends perfectly. It comes to an end in what? In perfection. That is what we are. Now, for some reason, most of us who are compassionate, we struggle, and we can't seem to be as compassionate as we want to be. So this is the frustration here, because I know that it's coming. It is coming. The situations are coming now, and people are going to get unhinged for sure. And this unhingement is going to be very strange, because we've had our friends, the cosmic corporate culture, cook up some very strange stuff. And we won't know what to do about it. It'll seem that if you keep trying to use your thought processes to deal with this, and your belief systems and pop culture to deal with this, you're going to be lost. You have to use spiritual affirmations to deal with this stuff that they've cooked up for us. Yeah, they've cooked up some very weird dishes for sure. So we can say, be not disturbed, all is well. Be not disturbed, all is well. All is perfect. All is perfect with everyone. And really, these great teachers see us all as the spirits that we are. They don't even see us at the level of bodies and personalities. Just superficially, like shadows, but that doesn't, they see us actually as how we actually are, and they see, oh, we're perfect. Nothing wrong with us. Absolutely flawless. So, what is this dementia or something? Nothing. Nothing but a passing cloud, you know. No consequence whatsoever. So my prayer is that everyone gets to this clarity, so they can all, we can all reassure one another that all is well. And these silly games of mental derangement are little puppet, just little silly puppet shows. We don't even have to pay any attention to them whatsoever. Nothing to see here. Let's move along. Nothing to see here. That's what we need. So my prayer is that everyone function this way, including myself. Everyone function this way. We thought in the 60s we'd be able to do that. But we found it was way more difficult than we thought. So a lot of us started using drugs, got pulled into sex, drugs, rock and roll, of trying to get to this compassion somehow. Yeah. We needed to see more clearly. We needed to somehow be more creative. We just couldn't. And, you know, we underestimated the difficulty of it. Because this cosmic corporate culture, they got all sorts of tricks up their sleeves, actually. I've been working at it for a long time. They're very clever magicians, you know. But you can't get to it that way. You have to get to it clearly, sanely, clearly, full stop in the wow of it. You know, it's not easy. Very challenging. Now we hear compassion. The Dalai Lama talks a lot about compassion. That's his main thing. And understood correctly, this is what we need to do. But most of us don't understand that correctly. We keep thinking we're human beings. We're not human beings. Not at all. A human being has as much to do with what we are as, let's say, we fall asleep or having a dream, and the dream is completely bizarre. We have no idea. The dream has absolutely nothing to do with reality, what we are, anything. The dream is just like something utterly bizarre. That's how much human being has to do with what we are. Nothing. Nothing to do with it. This world too has nothing to do with it. Nothing. So compassion is to reassure everybody that what they are is totally untouched by this bizarre dream, bizarre world, bizarre universe. Is has absolutely nothing to do with what we are, because we keep inferring that what we are must have some. This must have something to do. There's some correlation, you know. No, there isn't. We're expressing as an expression, but of spirit. We're trying to change what we are. So it's not an expression of what we are, really. It's an expression of the belief we can change what we are. And the idea of how to do this and how we would be when we're changed is is completely bizarre. Utterly bizarre. So we keep hoping that we can understand what we are through this world and other people and special relationships. It's not possible. It's not possible. That's why the spiritual path is necessary. You get it through affirmation of truth. Jesus calls these practices exercises. Now you have to believe in these exercises, have belief and faith, and know that they will work for you. Otherwise you start panicking and go back to thinking processes, and try to think about what about this, what can I grab of this world and this universe and bodies and all this culture and stuff that can help me with this. That'll just make things worse, pour gasoline on the fire. So you don't go there at all. I just refuse to go there. I just said, if the problem keeps coming up, I just keep saying, hey, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I am free. I am complete. I've never been a body. I've always been free. I don't need anything to complete me. I have never been a body. I have always been free. I don't need anything whatsoever to be me, to be perfectly me. I've never been a body. I've always been complete. I don't need a I've always been free. I've never been a body. I've always been free. I don't need anything whatsoever to be perfectly me. To be perfectly me. To be perfectly I am. I am. I am the oneness. I am the oneness. I am the oneness. I am the eternal oneness. I am the oneness right now. Only truth is true, nothing else is true. Nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists. I mean, we need to have several, we need to have these go-to. So the culture, musical culture, has songs, phrases of songs, and we're taught when we're in crisis. What I was part of is to help people when they're sick, crisis, mental, is to use music as therapy and to sing a song. Or listen to a song, or say a phrase of a song that feels has a lot of meaning for you, and that can pull you, center you. But what I found was, is it's not sufficient. It's not sufficient, and you actually need to go much deeper than that. Into truth is true, and nothing else is true. Pure abstraction, pure truth. This effectively deals with all the little. Silly little games, the puppet show of the cosmic corporate culture. Whereas the music doesn't have the gravitas and the effectiveness that's needed. So that's why I stopped being a musician and became a spiritual musician, so to speak. Because I realized this, we're up against what we're up against. You need to adjust the means. I don't have any ultimate attachment to music. I have an attachment to what works, to pragmatism. And pragmatically, we do need to use these spiritual bromides that are so potent. The medicine, it's the medicine we need right now. Music is not sufficient. Now, there was an attempt to waylay me away from this by what I call the goddess, who is this aspect of cosmic corporate culture who pretends to be all compassionate. And she claims she's in charge of compassion and how to help, mental problems and suffering and misery. And what she told me is that music is the answer. Music is the answer. And you just have to do spiritual music. And so she had me put all my attention into trying to revive my musicalness, musicality, which I had gotten away from by focusing on A Course in Miracles. And she said, no, that's too difficult. People can't understand. It's not really that helpful, but music's really helpful. And so I put a massive effort towards breaking back spiritual music. But, of course, this was all a con game by cosmic corporate culture to misdirect me. So I wouldn't be able now to help people with spiritual practice is what really works. See, they know they have a vulnerability, and they're vulnerable to these spiritual practices. Most definitely they are. You can bring your mind back into total serenity and peace and calmness and centeredness. No crisis here by these practices. So the last thing they want is for us to be able to go there, okay? So they tried to use me to make really beautiful spiritual music and tell people, this is it. This is what's going to calm you down in times of crisis. And of course, when times of crisis came, and the music was used, it wouldn't work. And then, of course, what would happen? Well, I get scapegoated. I get blamed, right? Say, oh, you didn't get the right music. You're the blame. So that's how it works. And it was done very, very cleverly. Cosmic corporate culture has some very clever actresses and actors and divas, devious divas, very devious divas, who goddesses who make you believe that they're the heart and soul of compassion. And they love everyone. And they want the best for everyone. No, they want the best. They love themselves. They want the best for themselves, actually. And they're part of this hive mind thing that thinks that hive mind is the answer, too. And so they feel that, whatever deception they can use is justified if it gets them more power, more energy, more people looking to them for answers. They think that somehow, magically, if everyone looks to them for answers, their bad advice will suddenly magically work. No, it won't. It won't at all. This is magical belief, magical thinking. as if everybody believes lies, somehow lies have become true. Like the ego tells us, its advice, the ego says, no, its advice is perfect. You just don't, not following it properly. Or somebody's interfering with it. You need to attack them. And here's the path. So, gradually, his voice is really under duress. Gradually, I saw through this charade because I was lied to, constantly lied to. The whole thing under a vast veil of secrecy, saying this is like so super important, again, nobody can know what's going on. Spin. Lie. Oh, sure, we're going to help you. Don't worry. We're almost ready to help you out. The whole thing's going to get going, and you'll be amazed at how effective it is. I said, hey, I mean, I'm drowning in debt, and there's no help at all coming. So no, you just need to do a little more work here. Show your faith a little more. You know, and they basically try to just destroy you because it's all a scam. This is the type of cleverness that we're dealing with, and they're very telepathic. That I was contacted telepathically through dreams, telepathically. I was definitely interacting with what seemed to be super, super intelligent, compassionate beings. And no, they weren't. They were deceivers. They absolutely were deceivers. And their goal was to take me away from Jesus and of course, in miracles. And the Bible, where Jesus is teaching also, is very evident. To this being a New Age troubadour, you know, that this is what's going to heal, make everybody happy and heal their minds. No, it won't. It'll make them seem happy with a split mind, with derangement, maybe, in some ways. But that's not what we really want at all. That's not what we really want. We want to be reassured that we're perfect. And this dream of imperfection is nothing whatsoever. Nothing but an idle wish. This is what we need. This is what Jesus tells us we need. So I wasted a lot of time, hopefully lesson learned. I'm still underwater, terribly underwater, and struggling horribly. This was a vicious, vicious campaign. They play hardball, to say the least. These cosmic corporate culture cultists. There's no lie that they won't tell you. There's no deception too elaborate for them to enact. They're very clever actresses and actors. They have studied the great saviors and saints of this planet. They know how to imitate them. They know how to act as if they are them. Okay? And this is how clever they are. Of course, if you're going to taking over planets, you will study the ones that we most trust the most and try to imitate them. Of course, that's part of their agenda. That's one of the main parts, you know, a very important part. They have a whole section devoted to that, of trying to imitate, you know, the ones that we rightfully have turned to, who have reassured us that we're perfect. Everything is fine. This is just a dream. And now they pretend that they are the return of these teachers. And here's what their advice is to do. And they give us the wrong advice. This is what happened to me. Had someone pretending to be like Ananda Maima and giving me this advice. This is what that she was returning. This is what the advice, that need to have this music ready and all this stuff, because she's going to cause a worldwide revival and save us all from mental collapse by having all this musical programs and everything. And, it was so realistically done. You know, it's astonishing. Astonishing. But it was deception, cosmic deception. These deceivers are quite clever indeed. Talk about selling yourself short. I mean, I'm perfectly capable, along with all of us, to realize our perfection and to radiate the same radiation that Ananda Maima radiated. I think what they were afraid of is that I would get to a point where I'd be able to be just as helpful as hers. Not quite, I would say. I don't, you know, that's, but close to it. I mean, just like Ramana Maharshi, you know, we can be close to that. And there's such exceptional They were so exceptional, of not a shred of concern whatsoever. No, but we can get to that. There's no question we can. And Jesus, what Jesus is teaching, will get us to that. They were quite extraordinary. But we can be very much like that. They were very much like, and that's what they were afraid of, you see. That's what they're afraid of. So they knew that I wanted to be like that. And they say, hey, you can be like Nanda Mahima, but the way to do it is to develop your musicality and put on these musical programs and spiritual music to help everybody, and then you'll be so happy, that will be your spiritual path. And and they knew that, so they used my desire to be like that to trick me. This is how clever these reprobates are. let's call them what they are at this point. They're perfect, like we all are, but they're taking an idol wish too so seriously that you might say they're playing out a play of being extreme reprobates. Need to be slapped on the hands, you know. need to have their hands slapped is what they need. And they will certainly get a good hand slapping. So, we can't be exactly like, essentially like Raman Maharshi. Our style might be a little different. Raman Maharshi told me himself, don't give up. You're going to make it. He knew all about the effort, to get me to quit and give up. And he said, no, you're going to do it. You can do it. And he's talking about being like him. That's what he's talking about. And we all can do this. We all can do it easily, actually. We think it's difficult. It's not really difficult. It's like when we're sound asleep, we can't imagine getting out of bed. We don't even know what a bed is. When we wake up, and we're a little bit wake up, and we realize, hey, I can get out of this bed. Just get up. Get up. It's not difficult. Get out of this dream. Stop dreaming. It's not difficult, really. Once you stop thinking you have to somehow assess all these different mental states, you don't have to assess any mental states at all. All for naught. They're all for naught. They don't have the slightest effect on what we are. So why do they need to be assessed? For what? For why? They don't. So eventually this total inclusive realization comes upon us. We just, wow, easy to awaken. No problem at all. So cosmic corporate culture, they don't want that to happen. And they know that there's some people here that are incapable and they're worried about it, so they try to mislead them by using the icons that they trust to mislead them. Absolutely. Many have been misled by actors pretending to be Jesus, for instance. Many. Jesus tells them this, tells them that, and then you need to do this and this and this and this is going to work. And they're being misled by cosmic corporate culture, by their division of misdirection, spiritual misdirection. These are people who have great faith in Jesus and want to be like him. Because of their continuity fear, they feel it's a little too difficult, and then they're told, oh, here's a shortcut, this way is going to work, and Jesus is actually telling you what you need to do, and it's like impossible, almost impossible to resist. Now, for me, Ananda Maima, the importance of that was I realized with this cosmic corporate culture taking over that men no longer had authority because they were seen as the bad ones because they were resisting this incorporation, whereas women were accepting the incorporation. They saw benefits. They were able to look and say, hey, I see a lot of beneficial stuff here. And this is good. This is good. We need to be in a wider group of different trade. Hey, trade, different products, different foods, different spices, different, yeah, this is interesting, it's intriguing. And the men who are working like slaves to keep buying money so they can buy, they're not so keen on stoking even more materialism, So men are not so keen on it, and women, women usually are the ones who notice trends way before men do and get with these new trends much sooner than men do, actually. Yeah, it's amazing. I mean, you see women and their hairstyles all change. And you look, start looking around, they're all look like they're all, they all know about it. And we don't even know about it at all. Like men, it's like, what the heck? How in the world? And they have some like secret network of sharing, they're aware of stuff. You know, these trends, they're very, very alert about new trends. And picking up, telling her, therefore you know it, boom, they're all doing it. So they picked up on this incorporation trend and realized, hey, I mean, they picked up on the Beatles just like, and all this stuff, and they were just like completely gone into this. And the us guys had no idea what happened. What is this? You know, we're listening to Beach Boys or something. And they looked at us like Beach Boys. We don't know what that is. You guys are so out of it. It's ridiculous. And they started wearing the, you know, the hairdos and the big sunglasses, and of course trying to look like ETs actually. So that they're more aware of trends. They pick up on trends quicker. They're quicker on this. So I realized that if you want to help the world spiritually, I realized that male authority, spiritual authority, was, as far as women were concerned, it was over. It's finished. Because they saw the cosmic corporate culture as the new authority. And of course, they were promised high places in it. In fact, they could promise they're actually in control of it, which is more or less true. But they were promised all sorts of stuff. And they saw opportunity, you know. And so what men had to say didn't matter anymore. Doesn't matter. Just didn't matter anymore, because they said, hey, you know, we see things that are, you know, really cool and beneficial. We want to run the show here. So it doesn't matter what you say, we want to be in charge, which is, you know, foolish, right? Because we're going through this crisis. So instead of practicing these spiritual practices that they're going to need, they thought that they're going to be in charge running the show, and that's going to protect them. Big mistake. And I tried to point this out of compassion, and they wouldn't listen. So I thought that they would listen to a woman, you see. So I said, I was told the nine of my mom would be coming back to the world and would talk to the whole world, especially the women of the world, and turn them away from this terrible mistake they're making, and they would listen to her. So I said, I'll do anything she wants, I'll serve her, as long as I get this message out and help the women of the world out of compassion, so that they do not fall into this trap. And they go back to true spiritual practice instead of lusting after high position and power and authority, bureaucratic officialdom, thinking that that is going to save their minds from breakdown. It's not. It's not going to save their minds from breakdown. So I was vulnerable in that way to being deceived by a female figure, a goddess, because I realized that nobody was going to listen to me. Because being a man, no one's going to listen to me. Especially women. And of course, men realizing that they feel they need to get with the trends of the females, because otherwise they're going to be looked at some old bogey that nobody, you know, just so out of it, nobody, no authority, no listen. So they say, we got to go along with this, you know. So they're not going to listen either. So this is the trouble. When you have compassion, you do things which could get you into severe trouble. Because otherwise you think, wow, it's just going to be useless. I can't help anyone in any way, really. See, we think, the delusion thinks, the ego thinks that position of power is what protects us, that makes us happy. Some part of a structure design, what level do you live on in this high-rise building, and what perks do you have? See, we think perks is what makes us happy, and so the world is going after like crazy, trying to get perks. You know, perks, yeah, deference. Who can say what to who? You know, who can say, hey, I don't like what your attitude. You need to change it, or you know, who has the power to say, hey, I'm offended. You have to change. You know, this is what everyone desperately after in this world, which is, you know, stupidity, and the cosmic corporate culture knows that. that's going to create a crisis in the world, which then people say, oh, we can't put our Humpty Dumpty minds back together again. We need someone who knows how to do this. And then they'll come on the scene, maybe with their fake teachers or whatever, however they do it. But so sure, you know, that's what we're here for. We knew that you were going to have this trouble. That's why we're here. That's what they'll say, you know. We've been watching and waiting for this time, my dear children, knowing that you're going through this crisis, and now we are here to save you from this crisis. We have all our expert teams and therapists, and we will know exactly how to help you out and all this stuff. Now, they're the ones who brought this crisis upon the situation. They're the ones who set it all up. Situation, reaction, solution. Cosmic corporate culture. What they want to do is indoctrinate everyone into their their cosmic corporate culture. You want the Earth? Sure. Let anyone come here. No problem. You want a resource? Sure. Take whatever you want. Sure. Yeah. It's like, we're good corporate citizens. We understand that we, you know. So this is the insanity that they want for everyone. And so compassion leads to trouble, for sure. It certainly has in my life. It causes constant suffering because you want to help, you can't seem to find a way to help. Maybe, you know, maybe if it, you know, you go transgender, maybe people listen to you, you know. Maybe Bruce, maybe that's what Bruce Jenner's doing. Sorry, Bruce, but, you know, he used to be an icon. He's from San Jose, hometown boy, you know. He was the all-American male. Now he's, maybe he's trying to be relevant, realizing nobody cares about the all-American male anymore. You know, there's an example. He says, wow, if I want any relevancy, I've got to become a woman. I've got to become a woman. And this is what many males feel, that you know, their relevancy is over because they just don't get it. They're not on the inside of what cosmic corporate culture. They haven't spotted the trends. They haven't been picking up on what they need to be like to fit in. But the women certainly have, no question about it. They're very up to date on it. See, us men are always seen to be behind the times, except when we pay attention to Jesus, which we're actually getting free of time. Big difference, right? Big difference. So I may seem to be behind the times, but it's only because I'm recognizing that time doesn't exist. That's why. Doesn't matter to me, these trends and stuff. It's just one ridiculous dream replacing another ridiculous dream, or different segment. Episode of a dream segueing into some other ridiculous episode of a dream. The dream of time, space, process, and form doesn't exist. There is no such thing as time. Jesus said it's possible to see this, to realize it, to see it. And I absolutely believe it. One moment. I absolutely believe it. Absolutely believe that. That it is absolutely possible to get free of this delusion of time, to see it doesn't exist. And he said, this is the grandest illusion of them all. But we can and we will get free of this delusion for sure. Maybe I can put on a wig or something and people will listen. Put on some lip gloss and a wig and pretend to be trendy or something like that. It's almost like transgenders now are the new spiritual authority on the planet, you know. Whatever. Weird stuff, huh? Bizarre stuff. How about truth being the spiritual authority on this planet? How about forgetting about the body? How about actual truth? Just the truth. The capacity. Who can give out this assurance? How about just certainty being the spiritual authority? Certainty. How about perfection being spiritual authority. See, this is what we need to look for. Not, you know, forget the body, but the actual. And those who have worked at that, actually worked at it. But the cosmic corporate culture comes bearing many, many chests full of glittering things. We know about the Internet of Things. People are getting themselves chipped right now because it helped them be recognized when they enter their home, and the home knows you're there and knows what you're doing and logs you in every way. People say, well, this is it. This is what we want. And so this cosmic corporate culture comes bearing all this gift of chests of things. Look at all these glittery, shiny, metallic, plastic, interesting texture. Things, look at the texture, all these glossy tiles, you know, wow, how we could redecorate this planet with, you know, I feel like in a redecorating mood, you know, maybe I should be an interior decorator or something. And yeah, let's redecorate the planet. Oh, look at all these things, how nice. I think I need to. Yeah, it's all about now the women, and because they know the trends, they know what the redecorating that needs to be done. How, you know, they know how to choose the right stuff, whatever that means, the right stuff, whatever's trending, to move things along, to progress, working in the general business of making people happy with their homes and stuff. It's always the woman that decides. Always the woman now. Man, you don't even really even talk to him. He's just kind of there, yes, and you know, tries to act like he's in on it. And when you say, okay, can we do it this way? He'll like freeze up and say, I better go ask the real boss or the big boss. And then, you know, meaning the wife, always. They can't make any decisions. They're not allowed to make any design decisions with this world anymore. They're not allowed. These are super wealthy, rich, influential people who work in business and stuff. They cannot. They absolutely cannot. It's the wife who makes all these decisions. It's the women of the world that are making the decisions. So they don't want to listen to what works, to make spiritual practice what actually is going to actually work. They won't listen. If they don't want to, they won't listen. And if they tell other people not to listen, most people will not listen. I've been told my whole life by women, don't do this, you know, don't go down that road. That's not what we want. I'm one of the rare people who refused to, you know, I said no to them. I'm going to do what I know is right. And that doesn't make them very happy at all, to say the least. And basically, they say the cosmos wants us to be running this planet. And so you can't go against the cosmos. The cosmos, really? What's the cosmos but a dream of the ego? Ego dream. It's spirit dreaming and trying to change reality. There's no purpose to the universe. There's no design. There's nothing to it really at all. It's just an idle wish. How can an idle wish say, you know, we want you to be in charge of this idle wish? It's all important to us. Because we can't complete what our mission is unless you're in charge. There is no mission at all. Because God can't be changed. That's change. That's just an idle wish. That's it. There's nothing more to it than that. So this whole idea, who's in charge, we need to be in charge, is utter nonsense. So, you know, I just refuse to go along with that. But you end up isolated, ignored, isolated. Just, you know, you don't exist, essentially. Because you're not part of the solution, as they think. You know, you're just so, don't exist. Well, we'll see how it goes. You never know. Just from straw poll of everyone I see, the men have no more will. They've been told that to exercise their will is evil and ruinous, and the cosmos hates them, and the cosmos loves their wives, and the women of the world here loves them, and the only way that men can get any love from the cosmos is through the women of the world, right? So they have to have relationship with the women of the world to get the love that the cosmos is giving the women. And the women then give that love to the men, if and only if the men do what the women tell them to do. This is the structure that cosmic corporate culture has put in place on this planet. And of course, what Jesus says is nothing like that whatsoever. He says, I am perfect, I am free. I am still exactly as God created me. There's not a single one of us that isn't absolutely, perfectly loved by God this very instant. Not one of us. And there's absolutely nothing we need to do for this to be so. This is true spiritual teaching. Jesus teaches us true. This is, I vouch for Jesus. He teaches us true. Okay? And no matter what cosmic corporate culture tries to do, and twist and spin, and, you know, twist and shout, they don't get it. They just don't get it. They're afraid to wake up. So, the men are terrified that they'll be cut off from love. You know, like, for instance, Marianne Williamson, who was claims to be one of the teachers of A Course in Miracles, and which is, she's actually works for cosmic corporate culture. She's tried to spin A Course in Miracles completely away from what it was in its intention. And she basically, her whole shtick is to say that men's purpose in the cosmos is to worship women. And what she's telling men is that the cosmos loves women perfectly and primarily, and then only through women do men get the love of the cosmos. But it's the women, only women know how to give that love to men, and men have to worship women in order to get this love. In other words, men need to be slaves, is what she's really teaching, is slavery, plain and simple. And this was obvious from the very get-go with her, you know, it's been completely obvious. And I think some people have recognized that. I'm not the only one. I maybe seen it very, very obvious, you know. Never bought into that. Again, I can see what you're up to, forget it. I'm not going to agree with that, no way. So, and if you don't go along with that, you're labeled a misogynist, a sexist misogynist. And all I'm saying is, no, I don't care about what the cosmos claims it's loving or loving. God loves me. God loves all equally, perfectly, this instant, without any exception, and there'll never be any exception. We can constitute this one perfect family right now. This is the truth, and I've seen it, and I've experienced it. There is no such thing as gender or differences or anything. We are one perfect spiritual family, and that's it. God, and of perfection. We are all absolutely perfect. This is the truth. So, why saying no to, you know, these quote-unquote love goddesses want us to worship them, you know, this whole scam of cosmic corporate culture. I'm standing up for compassion and truth for everyone. So it has nothing to do with sexism or misogynism, but it seems that way because the women are saying, no, you have to do, you know, get the love from us, and if you don't do that, then you're rejecting our role. You're putting us down. You're not letting us fulfill our true purpose in the cosmos. You hate us. You're against us. You're bigoted. You're prejudiced. No, no, no. No, they're trying to con us. They're con artists is what they are. And so we're just saying no to the con, okay, because this... If we don't say no, if we don't get to laugh at this ridiculousness, we will find our minds seemingly split and unstable, like we're insane, and it will scare the heck out of us, and we'll be in terrible suffering mode. So it's saying yes to compassion, to say no to these con artists. How many among us can do that? Because the backlash is quite severe. I've already gone through many, 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 many efforts to push back the lie. I can say that pushing the prez, you know, the POTUS, was the biggest backlash of all, for sure. For sure. They got a lot invested in him. Huge, huge, huge investment there. So I'm not gonna keep pushing on that one for a while, you know. It's heavy waters there. We're very reinforced. A lot of moats around that castle, you know. That's for sure. But the game is up. You know, the game is up. Let's just face it, okay? The game is up. This whole nonsense about the cosmos loving, you know, the love of the cosmos and the specialness of women and all this whole thing and the cosmo-cobra culture, it's all nonsense. The game is up, all right? This is a dream. This is a ridiculous, totally unneeded dream. Fantasy. This universe is a fantasy. Completely unnecessary. Has nothing to do with what we are. We are perfectly loved forever, eternally, no matter what we choose to think or experience or even dream. Has absolutely nothing to do with us doing anything to please anybody whatsoever. This is what Jesus teaches. So those who have been spinning Jesus' teachings, and there have been plenty of them doing that, folks, the game is up. You might as well repent right now. Of course, you probably won't. But we're not going to hold our breaths. But we know at some point, eventually, you will. And we'll be very happy. We'll be delighted. In fact, we're already delighted for you because we know you will. We know you will repent. Will anybody in time say, whoa, oh my gosh, you know, yeah, I do need to, no, they're still, I don't know, but they're still grinding their gears about trying to talk it out and point it out, thought process, no, it's not about thought process anymore, okay, this is hardball that's going on here on this planet. What was one of my goals in life was to be a Major League Baseball player and make the Hall of Fame. So I love hardball. You know, bring it on. This is hardball that's taking place here. Real hardball. And so you gotta be hardball and say, hey, I gotta do these practices. I gotta actually do these I gotta actually say this. I gotta actually keep saying it. I repeat it for hours on end. Truth is true, nothing else is true. Truth is, with will, say, this is true, and there's no discussion at all about it. There's no thought process at all. This is just complete, holistic statement of truth, and that's it. And I better stop the video because this cold chill outside is gonna be, you know, challenge me a bit, but at least I'm doing it. So, yeah, these are the times to try our spirits, for sure. And heads up, and I just hope, I'm just going to keep trying and see what happens. Don't give up. These exercises that I've introduced in so many videos are super potent and give the lie to this massive cosmic con that believes that we're their playthings here, you know, that this is fun. No, it's not fun. If you think it's fun, you'll think differently once you go through these all sorts of fragmentations. At least, you know, I mean, some people think that that's cool for a while, but a lot of us don't. So we don't want to go there. So definitely, use the practices. Somehow, but I have not had enough feedback on this. I don't know where anyone's at whatsoever, but I will certainly keep you doing it. I will certainly keep doing it because it works and it's necessary. Okay, I gotta go inside now. Very great. That's it.